The Sword of the Lady by S.M. Stirling. Narrated by Todd McLaren. Copyright 2009 by Stephen M. Stirling. This unabridged audiobook is published by arrangement with S.M. Stirling and Scoville Galen Ghosh Literary Agency, Inc., and was produced in the year 2009 by Tantor Media Incorporated, which holds the copyright thereto. Chapter 1. Shining pearl within the crimson sky, guide me in the coming night. Perfect seed within the humble husk, ground my feet in soil so I may rise. Patient leaf within the endless pool, calm me when the torrent falls. Gentle wind within the slanting grass, bear me ever on until I rest. The Wild Lands, formerly Illinois. Middle Illinois River. August 18th, change year 24, 2022 AD. Rudi Mackenzie and a Dane hadn't been singing the hymn. More of a breathy whisper, though it rang loud in their minds as the moon rose enormous on the horizon, and they'd come down here below the lip of the valley, where there was more cover for the right. Rudi stopped instantly when a stick snapped. The warm sense of communion ghosted away like dust in a desert, and he sank down behind the tangle of wild rose in a motion that was swift but smooth rather than a catch-the-eye jerk. 5 paces to his right and a little behind him, a Dane Aylward Mackenzie did the same. His great shaggy half-mastiff bitch garb vanished even more completely, belly to the ground, ears cocked, and only her black nose moving as it wrinkled. The air wasn't moving enough to carry scent any distance, but her blocky, barrel-shaped head seemed to split as the thin, black lips drew back silently from her long, yellow fangs. The other half of her was probably wolf. Both men listened hunter fashion, with their whole bodies, not straining, but opening themselves to the summer twilight, letting sound and sight and smells and the movement of air on skin flow in until you knew. The evening hush was strong, and the hot, thick air hazy along the ridge where they lay above the river valley, full of rank odors of flowers and greenery and warm earth damp from yesterday's thunderstorm. Sweat trickled down Rudy's flanks beneath the brigantine torso armor he wore, a corselet of little steel plates riveted between 2 layers of soft green leather. Something with too many legs bit the back of his left knee below the kilt and above the sock hose, adding to the prickling itches. The coarse, sandy grain of the leather on the riser grip of his longbow drank moisture from the palm of his left hand, growing damp but not slippery, which was the point. The steep fall of ground to the river below was a patchy, almost forest. Single stands, or clumps of mature, pre-change bur oak and shag bark hickory, black walnut and sugar maple, reared above teardrop-shaped surrounds of saplings, where they'd rolled their seed downslope in the decades since the state foresters had stopped coming to prune and tend. The new growth ranged from fresh sprouts to fair-sized trees as old as Rudi. But the canopy wasn't tall or closely spaced enough to shade out the undergrowth yet, and a dense understory of weeds and scrub was just past its summer prime. The open spaces were brushy meadows scattered with white pasture thistle and Queen Anne's lace, and thickets of 4-foot-tall gara, its pink flowers a wash of fading color as the deeper scarlet of its leaves turned black with sunset. The faint, sweet scent of it became stronger with crushed stems and petals. As the sun dropped lower behind him, he could see the tops of the plants swaying in little jerks in 6 spots. Once, a moment's stillness. Twice. Again. Another pause.
And there's no wind, Rudi thought grimly, as his mouth went dry.
He was only 23, but he'd seen enough violent death to know how easily it could happen to him, know in body and blood, as well as his head. He kept his breaths long and deep and slow to help loosen the tightness in gut and crotch
and slow the pounding of blood that were the instinctive response to a sudden, deadly threat. Half of transcending fear was making the flesh serve the spirit's need, instead of letting it command you. And breathing deep could give you a little extra endurance at need. Not much, but every bit counted at the narrow passage. His eyes stayed fixed on the vegetation, and the off and on course of the small, betraying motions.
Men crawling on their bellies then, moving a bit at a time and pausing in between. Men or wolves or wild dogs, they all know that trick. But I'd be betting the first.
Here in the wild lands, men would most likely attack him on sight, and they'd likely be faster than he afoot over ground they knew. He glanced over to where a Dane waited, a movement of eyes more than head, and got a very slight nod. That meant both agreement that they were undetected so far, and waiting on you, Chief. Here and now, that was both a burden and a comfort. The call was his, but you couldn't ask for a better man than a Dane to have your back for all he was just turned 20. Rudi moved his right-hand fingers, thumb to each as if counting on them, then turned it palm up and lifted it a bit, a combination of gestures that meant how many in clan war sign. A Dane's answer was a tiny shrug. He didn't have any real idea either.
So, no less than 6, possibly about 30 if they're very good. And they haven't seen us yet. It's someone else who's the expected guest of the feast, and them laying the table and knocking out the hung of the barrel of red salt ale. Someone coming by the track down there along the river, the position they're in will be invisible from down by the water's edge.
The ambush was being set with real skill. He doubted most Mackenzie warriors could have done it better, or even Dunedain rangers. He kept his breathing slow and quiet and deep, and his body motionless with a silent wariness that was coiled rather than stiff, ready to explode off the ground if he must. Nothing moved but his eyes, and he flicked them back and forth. A steady fixed gaze was oddly noticeable to the one you were staring at, like brushing a feather over the nape of the neck. If it was only 6 or so savages, then he and a Dane could probably handle them, not taking into account whoever they were planning on ambushing. The 2 Mackenzies would have the advantage of surprise, height, good purpose-made armor and weapons, rather than crude makeshifts, and skills none of the wild men could match.
But there's also the matter of the rights and wrongs of the thing, so.
The ones walking into this ambush might be men of deep-dyed wickedness for all he knew, and meeting their fate. This wasn't his territory, and he wasn't one to draw the blade on strangers lightly.
On the other hand, I need friends here, or at least allies. I've no time to spare. The lives of my friends depend on it. And at 7th and last, fights are usually about us and them, not rights and wrongs. Needs must when the fates drive.
Half in prayer,
and if this deed must return on the door, then let it fall on me. It's my decision, and a Dane but follows his chieftain. This is a burden I took up with the sword.
A warrior's cold appraisal took over. They could certainly shoot at least 3 or 4 each before the enemy came close enough for handstrokes, perhaps more if there were many targets. If it was 30 of them, that was a different matter altogether. There was a certain brute simplicity to the arithmetic of war. 30 men weren't 15 times stronger than 2.
More like 40 or 50 times stronger, he thought unhappily. The advantage grows as the square of the difference, other things being equal.
Nor was there any absolute certainty of safety whatever when men fought to kill. Sheer luck was involved if your eye was in the place where a random arrow wanted to go. Then it was off to the Summerlands willy-nilly. He hadn't come all the way from the Willamette in Oregon to die in a little skirmish 2/3 of the way to his goal. Too much depended on him. Their horses were behind and above them, in the strip of fire-scarred brushy woods where the open prairie met the valley, all loose-tethered, except his mare Epona, who was guarding them. He made a low chittering sound between his teeth, something that melded into the natural buzz and twitter and creak of the wilds. That would keep her quiet, even if she scented another horse or heard it neigh. The problem was that it wouldn't mean anything to a Dane's horse or the pack beast, who were
not more than average bright, even for horses. I love horses, but Epona aside.
He was glad he'd done so a minute later, when the dull thud and clop of hooves sounded on the broken asphalt and dirt of the roadway that followed the Illinois River below. Four men rode into sight, with as many more pack horses on leading reins. They were bundles over their backs, and from the look of them and the trail of flies, those held butchered game carcasses strapped up in the hides. Between them and Rudi, the brush moved again, and he thought he caught the glint of edged metal through the gloaming of the summer evening. Someone was being a little overeager, or had forgotten to dip the blade of his spear in mud.
Ambush, Sean and I had the right of it, Rudi thought. They're concentrating on the road down there, and with the sun at their backs to blind anyone looking their way, though which means they can't see me and a Dane easily either, of course.
From what he'd heard in Iowa, the only dwellers here were vicious savages, descendants of city folk who'd lived through the first change years by eating each other, worse and worse as you went farther east. That had been Ingolf's opinion, too, and Ingolf Vogler had made his living off salvage expeditions into the dead cities for many years. Journeying halfway across the continent with him had taught Rudi that the man from Wisconsin was usually a good judge.
On the other hand, a Dane and I cannot haul all those wagons of treasure to the Mississippi alone, Rudi mused. From the way things have gone this past week, we can't even get close to them without help from the folk hereabouts.
He ducked lower and thoughtfully picked up his salad helm and set it on his head, with the visor slid up along the low steel dome and locked in place, and the sponge and felt lining pressing firmly around brow and temples and the back of his skull. Then he reached over his shoulder to his quiver for a shaft to set on his string. A Dane did the same with his open-faced helmet, knocked one arrow, and eased out three more from his quiver, holding them between one finger and his bow, a trick for rapid shooting. If they were careful, there was little chance the ambushers would notice, and it was well to be ready. Also, the dull, matte-green surface of the steel was less conspicuous than the raw, metallic brightness of his shoulder-length, red-blonde mane, or even the sun-streaked oak-brown of a Dane's curly mop.
And haul those wagons to Iowa I must, since that is the price demanded to release Matty. And Ingolf and all my friends and kin by that.
Right now he had to keep his mind cool, thinking Mad Tyrant of Anthony Heselrode would just make him rage, though the very gods knew it was accurate.
By that eccentric gentleman, the boss man of Iowa, will there ever be a chance with less risk? Even trying to back away might spook the ones hiding there. And what better, quicker introduction to the men they mean to kill than a rescue? If I must work with cannibals or the children of such, I will.
After all, if you got too choosy about people's ancestors.
Were the Gael not once headhunters who burned men alive as sacrifices? Did the English not come to these lands with fire and massacre? And was not my Anam Charamati's father a monster to turn a man's stomach, sure?
Decision gelled. With his free hand, he reached down and picked up a clod of soil, touching it to his lips in silent prayer for an instant.
Earth must be fed.
To take life was to accept your own death's part in the world, and the gesture acknowledged it. A Dane copied the motion, and they both set their fingers to the strings of their longbows. The horsemen riding unaware into the trap down the road below were stripped to the waist in the muggy heat, regardless of the mosquitoes that were beginning to whine. Even at 100 yards and through the gloaming, he could see that three of them carried long spears tipped with ground-down butcher knives, and they all had a clutch of javelins slung over their backs as well in something like a big quiver. Then the still air shifted, and a little breeze cuffed at leaf and twig around him, cooling the sweat that stuck strands of his hair to the back of his neck between the flare of the helm. The horses tossed their heads at the scent of their own kind. One nickered and was answered by an equine snort from behind the two Mackenzies. Rudi came smoothly to his feet, as swiftly as if he and the animal had practiced the signal together.
"Ambush!"
he shouted, his trained voice throwing the sound from deep in his chest.
"Trap in the brush above you!"
The scrub exploded with armed men. Screams and ragged figures and the ugly sheen of spearheads. Many more than he'd thought there would be. But it was too late to undo his decision. They wavered for a moment, caught between the foemen they had expected to take unawares and the strangers above them.
"Closer to 30 than to 6 of them. More like 40, the Dagdag clubbed them dead,"
went through him in a flickering instant.
"I do hope the men they wanted to kill can take some of the weight."
"Morago!"
Rudi screamed, to rivet their attention.
"Morago!"
He called on the crow goddess as he drew and shot, for she was the one whose feathered host fed on the fruits of battle, the dark mother who had sent Raven to claim him and the Nemed when he was still a child. A Dane simply howled, the cry of the wolf that was his sept-totem, and then their voices rose together in the racking banshee shriek of the clan's battle yell. One of the ambushers had a short, stiff bow of some sort ready, and he had the presence of mind to turn and aim at the tall figure on the slope above. Rudi had already started to draw Mackenzie style past the angle of his jaw as he called the warning, shoulders and gut and hips as much as arms and the force that bent the great stave of yellow yew wood. But a Dane was a fractional second ahead of him. The clothyard shaft snapped out as he let the string roll off his fingertips and lash at the bracer on his left forearm. The range was short, and his warbow drew well over 100 pounds. The arrow was a blurred streak in the dimness, and then a crack of parting bone before the enemy archer flipped backward with a gray goose fletching standing up like a brutal exclamation point from his face. A Dane's shaft hadn't missed either. It went through the man's torso in a double splash, breaking ribs going in and coming out, then stuck the next man behind in the stomach and stayed there. Rudy's hand flicked to the quiver again and again, knock, draw, aim, loose, in the deadly fast ripple Mackenzies were taught from childhood, 3 seconds for an arrow. They were both shooting wherever a telltale shape or motion betrayed the obvious threat of an enemy archer. Some sort of leader grabbed ambushers and pushed them towards the pair of clansmen as he yelped an order in a yammering dialect. It cut off in a gurgling scream as a Dane shifted aim and sent an arrow through his throat. A score of the wild men came uphill at the Mackenzies in a bounding rush, while as many more boiled down towards the river. They must have thought there were more than 2 new foemen, fooled by shock and the eye-watering brightness that lingered behind him and the shower of clothyard arrows stabbing down at them.
"Left! Mine!"
Rudi called sharply as the foe came on in a yelling mob, then spread out into a rough line. The enemy must have some concept of archery. They knew that they had to get across the killing ground as fast as they might. They had no idea at all of what the West Country longbow could do in skilled hands, from the way they came straight on, regardless, with their shields up instead of dodging to and fro as they charged. And they were about to learn.
Snap! Snap!
The waxed linen of the bowstrings struck their leather bracers with a light whapping sound, and the arrows blurred out with a whoosh of cloven air. A man dropped from each end of the attacker's rough formation, with a flat, punching smack of arrowheads striking flesh, loud enough to hear.
Snap, 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 snap!
4 more men died in 8 seconds, 3 instantly, and 1 screaming and thrashing as a cedarwood shaft hammered through shield and arm and chest before it lodged in his spine. Then the rest were upon him. Snarling, shouting, hairy faces, vaguely seen as they labored up the hillside as if from a well of darkness, weapons reaching for his life. He tossed aside the bow and swept out his longsword in a hiss of steel on greased wood and leather. The other hand stripped the little buckler from its clip on the scabbard. He was the second-ranked archer in the clan Mackenzie, who were a people of the bow. But Rudi had never met his own equal with a sword since he got his full growth, not anywhere in his travels. Not yet. Everything slowed, sound burring deeper, vision fading except for faces, hands, weapons. He felt light and easy, his motions flowing like water over rocks in a mountain torrent.
"I'm dead if I let them get around me and settle themselves," he knew. "And I must keep their eyes on me and away from a Dane. He has my back."
Existence was a dance through the purple dusk. Lines precise as those scribed with compass and surveyor strings, linking blade to target. It was Riastrad, the battle madness of the warrior goddess whose scythe reaped men. He charged, shrieking, clearing the bush ahead of him with a long, lunging stride. A yard of layer-forged steel in his fist and the eerie, keening scream of the Mackenzies on his lips. A rust-pitted spearhead ground down from one blade of a pair of garden shears went over his right shoulder as he ducked beneath a thrust, and he struck with a buckler as it did. The soup-plate shape of the metal shield cracked into a face covered in a black beard that crawled with lice, hard enough to make bone crumble and throw the wild man backward to roll down slope in a tangle of limbs. With the weight of his armor added in, there were better than 200 pounds behind the blow, and the man wouldn't be getting up again. The twinge from the old wound in his right shoulder was distant, unimportant except to remind him of how the infected arrow had weakened it a little. In the same instant, the blade in his left hand flicked out, the point driving through a throat and past it with scarcely a tug. Behind it, a spray of droplets hung in the air for a second, black in the dying light. There was a whistling behind him and an ear-splitting scream as an arrow struck and lodged in bone. More hissed past to strike, once close enough for the fletching to brush the skin of his neck in passing. The first-ranked archer in the clan was in back of him, twice winner of the silver arrow at the Lunasad Games, and a hunter of beasts and men. Then another cry of horrified pain, beneath a roaring growl. Garb was at work protecting her master as he shot, darting in to slash at a hamstring, and then close her great jaws on the man's face as he fell, jerking him back and forth as she worried at what her long fangs held. The twisted, gorgon mask of Rudy's face made a man stumble back in mid-attack and die an instant later in a galvanic convulsion as the sword point flicked into and out of his eye faster than a frog's tongue licking up a passing insect on the wing, punching through the thin bone and into the brain. Another time, and the grating, crunching sensation that flowed up his hand and arm might come back to leave him sweating and clenched in some moment of peace. Now it was only a slight tug on his wrist as he wrenched the sword free and sliced down a spear shaft in a motion that left a long curl of wood flying free with the wielder's fingers. A thunder of hooves and a Pona was there, her eyes white and rolling, her great slab teeth bared as she bugled a challenge. One of the wild men looked around just in time to see her milling forehooves come down on him like steel-shod warhammers, and threw up his arms in a gesture as futile as his scream. The remaining attackers crowded forward towards Rudi, half attacking him, half fleeing her. A thought flickered through some remote corner of his mind.
"There are people who think horses can't be dangerous because they eat grass."
A stab as precise as a surgeon's scalpel in over the collarbone, and a man collapsed with a great mass of arteries above the heart severed. The withdrawal turned into a smashing backhand chop that sent a spearhead pinwheeling away into the evening, with half a foot of shaft still attached. He slid forward in a smooth, savage rush. The man made one futile jabbing motion with a stub before Rudi cracked the pommel of his sword into the temple and drove bone splinters into his brain.
"Get in close," he thought.
He leapt over the hawking swing of a blade that had probably started life as some sort of hedging tool and was near enough to the weapon Westerners called a billhook. It hissed beneath his boots, and one of the wild men screamed as it struck his leg, as much in rage as pain. Rudi kicked as he landed, a solid heel strike to the billman's knee. Something gave under the boot with a grisly, snapping, crunching sound.
"Ignore that one. He's out of it."
He pushed off the impact, using it to swing himself around, the long sword slashing horizontally as he spun.
"Get close. Get close."
Too close for anyone to draw a spear back for a stab, and himself a whirling, screaming, striking blur that left death and ululating agony in its wake as the melee stumbled across the hillside's uncertain footing. Edges and clubs grated and banged on his helmet, thumped into his brigandine, hard enough to leave bruises he'd feel later, if he lived. They were striking at the head and body from instinct, unused to dealing with real armor and not knowing how vulnerable they were to his ironclad violence.
"If I had full war harness on and a knight shield, I could take the lot of them."
But he didn't, and it could only be seconds until sharp metal hit something unprotected and vital, throat or limbs. He couldn't block a dozen men, couldn't kill them all. There wasn't time. An axe looped towards his neck. Rudy's buckler deflected it with a crang, and his sword licked down on the man's arm above the elbow. The edge cracked into bone and through it with an ugly thump that jarred up the weapon and into his arm and shoulder. The man spun away, staring at the bleeding stump and then sitting down to die. Startled as the blood spurted over her fetlocks, Epona stopped stamping a body into rags of flesh and bone splinter, and reared to pound her hooves into him instead. Rudi recovered with desperate speed, and a spray of leaves and twigs beneath his boots, but the next man was poised with his spear cocked back to thrust into Rudy's face, the lunge already beginning. And he froze. With an expression of intense surprise on his features for an instant, as a wet, red point appeared through his chest. Then he went flaccid and collapsed at the Mackenzie's feet. Behind him, a horseman swerved his mount and snatched another javelin out of the hide bucket slung over his back, throwing it with a whoop. The shadowed woods were alive for an instant with leaping, fleeing men, throwing aside their weapons to run with heedless speed and crashing through the thickets as the horsemen they'd ambushed harried them on. Rudi thrust the point of his sword into the earth as a support, leaning with his mouth open to suck in the air his lungs craved, despite the raw stinks it bore. His other arm went around Epona's neck as she nuzzled him, the sweet, grassy, musky scent of her breath and sweat strong in his nostrils as he panted. The wave of rage that had filled his veins and nerves like liquid fire cooled, leaving his skin rippling with a sudden cold and his body full of a leaden weakness. Suddenly, half a dozen minor cuts stung like itching fire above the duller ache of the wrenched and battered muscle. For a moment, he was not sure if the gathering darkness was natural or the product of a body driven beyond its limits. Fighting was the hardest labor in the world. He was young and very strong and in hard condition, but his body still tried to shake like an overworked horse, and he had to swallow again and again with a paper-dry mouth to keep the heaves from starting. His trainers back home, Mackenzie's and Bear Killers and Association Knights alike, had warned him that he pushed himself too hard. So had Master Howe in Shenrezi Monastery, in the Valley of the Sun, where they'd taken refuge last winter from blizzards and pursuers. He'd been more specific about it, too.
"There is a deep inner well that the body can tap, a store of great strength and of great speed. Most never reach it, and of those who do, most only when uttermost need breaks down the barriers. A few by long training in the inner disciplines. But you, Raven Man, you can open that gate by wishing it so. It is in your nature. Be cautious with this gift. The merciful Buddha buried this deep within us for a reason. It is the last reserve against extremity. You shorten your life a little each time you draw from it.
The problem being, of course, that having your skull dished in, or 6 inches of steel shoved through your gut, shortened life by much more than a little. He was very good with a blade, but nobody was good enough to deal with fighting many against one, unless something took him beyond himself. His skin quivered again. And you didn't feel the fear until afterwards, some place in the mind knowing how it would be when the edged metal grated through your eye sockets and the world went black.
There's a place beyond the gate, and we return, he thought, not for the first time, but not to this life. Death is a forgotten, whether it comes in terror like a tiger hunting in the night, or as the gentle mother whose last gift is an end to pain. I'm not through being Rudi Mackenzie yet. Yet neither were these ready, who had their own purposes and needs. Dreadlord, keeper of laws, be gentle with those torn untimely from the world of men, and me also when my hour has come.
He'd straightened when the three horsemen returned from their pursuit, and was wiping his blade on a swatch of rags torn from a body. A Dane stood ready with another arrow on the string, discreetly pointed down and not drawn. Yet. Garb was glaring at his heel, tongue licking her reddened muzzle, ready for a leap to take a man out of the saddle. Epona abandoned a rear as Rudi grabbed at her hackamore with his free hand. You didn't use a bit on her, and she prepared to tolerate the men as she did those around him when he asked it of her.
Three. They lost a man then. All of them wounded, but none very badly.
She tossed her head and whickered a little disdainfully at the stranger's mounts. They were all shorter than her 17 hands of sleek black height, and none had her long-limbed grace. Their harness was crude. Simple pad saddles and pre-change bridles, patched and repaired with bits and pieces of this and that. The Mackenzie chieftain waited with the sword still drawn, ready to strike if the three were inclined to add him to the larder.
All you one, Westmen, their leader said to Rudi, dismounting and extending a hand to them both in turn.
Ah, they can tell we're from west across the Mississippi. From the gear, most likely. Though probably not quite how far west.
I'm Jake Summer Jake, and these are my bros, Tuck and Samuel.
His smile revealed several missing teeth.
We runs with the South Side Freedom Fighters. I'm the big man of South Side. You save our asses.
Rudi thrust his sword into the earth and took the man's hand, as calloused as his own and very strong for his size. Probably big man meant something like chief. The native of the wild lands was several inches shorter than his own 6'2", and failed to match a Dane's 5'9 by a finger or so. He was wiry slender, with a sparse young black beard and hair haggled off below his ears and eyes so crow-colored that the pupil disappeared in the iris. The dark olive face was scarred and weathered, but he judged the man was about his own 23 years, give or take. His short pants of crudely tanned and worse-sewn rabbit skins were held up by a broad belt with a buckle of salvaged metal. His weapons were a knife and a hatchet besides his javelins, and all but the wooden shafts of the throwing spears looked to be of pre-change make. His eyes were shrewd as he took in a Dane's bow, and he nodded at the peace gesture as the archer returned his arrow to the quiver. They went a little wider as he looked around and realized how many of the enemy had long, gray-fletched shafts in their bodies, and how far away some of them were. Both were obvious as the younger Mackenzie went about the grisly but essential task of retrieving intact arrows and the heads of the broken ones. It was also obvious how easily they'd smashed through crude armor, leather studded with bits of metal, wooden shields surfaced with salvaged stop signs,
and similar makeshifts for the most part. The one body wore a modern male shirt, stolen or bartered from the other shore of the Mississippi. That hadn't helped its wearer either, though it made it harder to get the arrow out undamaged. "Can I see?" he said. "That's new." A Dane shook his head wordlessly as he grasped an arrow delicately with both sets of forefinger and thumb and pulled. He didn't like letting strangers touch his longbow. That one had been a special gift from his father, Aylward the Archer, the old man's personal war bow that he'd set aside when he could no longer bend it. Rudi bent to retrieve his own and let the other man try it. Jake grunted incredulously. His arms were knotted with hard, lean muscle, but they quivered and shook, and he abandoned the effort before the string was halfway to his jaw. Drawing the great war bow wasn't just a matter of raw strength, though it needed that, too. You had to have the knack, and that came from long and constant training. Mackenzies started their children at age 6 or so. Adane slipped his own weapon into the carrying loops beside his quiver, cleansed his hands on a tuft of grass, and pointed to the bow riding behind one of the horsemen's saddles with a crook-fingered, "Let me have that," gesture. The rider hesitated for a moment, then handed it down. "Fiberglass," the young Mackenzie archer said at the feel of the stave. That meant it was pre-change, and lucky not to have aged and cracked into uselessness. The stuff the old world had confusingly called plastic mostly didn't rot, but it lost strength and suppleness unpredictably. Then he bent it with one contemptuous finger on the string, before handing it back.
20-25 pounds draw. Not but a toy for little children, and feeble children at that, sure.
Most warriors were proud of their gear. Rudi could see the man begin to bridle before he looked around and spat in reluctant agreement. Jake pushed a body over on its back with his foot. "Knifers," he said, pointing a bare toe at two long-heeled zigzag scars on the dead man's cheek like parallel thunderbolts, evidently some tribal mark.
"Shigman's boys. All three bunches got together for this. Better we get out of here."
One of the others snorted.
"Runs all him till dark after this coming."
"They'll still be running at sundown tomorrow," Rudi translated mentally. Jake shrugged.
"Mays they come back. Tuck, Samuel, get going."
The other two Southsiders had a family resemblance to their leader, save that one was naturally dark brown of skin with tight curled hair and broader features, and the other pale blonde. The ragged blankets all three had thrown over their saddle bows were probably their only other garments, and their bare feet were broad, calloused enough that they likely went so always unless the weather was freezing. As the leader spoke, his companions were collecting any weapons worth having and making sure of the enemy wounded. Rudi grimaced slightly to himself. That was sometimes needful, but never pleasant. Much harder than killing in the white-hot savagery of battle. He noticed with relief that the wild men were going about it with a rough mercy, taking care to make the final stroke as quick as possible. The sounds of agony died down into an echoing silence.
"Yous got free about turf,"
Jake went on to the Mackenzie clansman.
"Come south side fires anytime you want. Sit down and put a hand in the pot like a freedom fighter stud."
Rudi had to strain for a moment to understand the words through a thick accent, harsh and slurred and nasal at the same time, that turned these into these and are into er.
"My thanks to you, Jake, son of Jake," he said, slowly and clearly. "My name's Rudi Mackenzie, of the clan Mackenzie. My septotum is Raven. This is my blade brother and sworn man, a Dane Aylward Mackenzie, called the Archer of the Wolf Sept. And you saved my life with that last spear cast as well, so I'm thinking we're even so."
From his frown, Jake found Rudy's lilt, stronger than most in Clan Mackenzie and the product of Juniper Mackenzie's own County Mayo accent, hard to follow as well. One of his tribesmen brought up a horse with a dead man across it.
"That's our bro, Murdy. The bastards killed him.
Jake said. To the air.
You don't haunt us none, Spook Murdy, 'cause we got 'em for you.
The others in the Southsider party added more to the same effect. Rudi nodded approval. It was a warrior's duty to avenge his comrades, and a kinsman's too.
And speaking of duties, now that we have time.
He and a Dane each bent to one of the bodies of the slain foeman, touched blood to a finger and that to his forehead. Then they faced the west, and he murmured with raised hands,
"To your black wing host, we dedicate the harvest of this unplowed field, Morrigu, Lady of the Ravens. Dread Lord of Death and Resurrection, guardians of the Western Gate, guide the souls of these, our foemen, to the lands of summer, where no evil comes and all hurts are healed. Goddess, mother of all, gentle and strong, through whose cauldron we are all reborn, witness that we kill these your children from need and duty, not wantonness, knowing that for us also the hour of the spear shall come, soon or late, for earth must be fed."
"So mote it be,"
a Dane finished. They exchanged a glance and a slight nod. Rudi could tell the other Mackenzie was adding the same silent observation.
"And return these rotters in better condition for the next go-round on the wheel, once they've spent some time with you."
Jake gave Rudi a sharp look.
"Hey, that's a good saying word to keep spooks down. You two aren't part of those bastards from Iowa, are you? You sure don't sound like them, and they pray to the Jesus man."
It took Rudi a moment to realize what "dose bastards" meant. He made a mental effort to switch sounds and fill in the missing parts of speech.
"No, that I am not," he said. "We are from the far west, from the lands of sunset, where we follow the star goddess, who is also Earth the Mother, and her consort, the Sun Lord."
"Well, some of us do," he thought.
"I came to Iowa with my friends on a journey eastward.
To the farthest east, to the lands of sunrise, to seek a sword seen in visions. That might perhaps be a wee bit complicated to discuss right now. Also, the way the prophet's men pursue us."
"And the boss men's men set on us and took them captive."
"Which oversimplifies a bit, but is true in the essence."
"He holds them hostage until I return with a treasure. Wagons left on a road north of here, just past a ruined town. The fall of 3 years ago now."
Jake's brows went up. It was visible in the light of moon and stars.
"Those? We know 'em. Nothing worth taking there. We checked. Not cloth or saddles or blades or nothing. Wagon's too big for us, so we left them. Maybe haunts there. Maybe bad spook luck."
Rudi shrugged and smiled.
"They're what he wants, nonetheless, and I've been trying to get them and not be killed by everyone I meet."
"Talk about it later," Jake said.
He glanced up at the sky, obviously judging distance and time by the stars.
"We gotta get Murdy away before we bury him. Otherwise the knifers still track and dig him up and eat his heart and balls."
The dark young man, Tuck, spat on one of the bodies.
"Bastards, eaters, monsters."
"Monsters?"
Rudi asked, as they collected the Dane's mount and the pack animal with their gear. The living men mounted and headed westward along the river. Fireflies flickered across the waters, and a cool, wet breath came from the river's surface. Rudi took a deep lungful, glad to be away from most of the stink of blood and open bodies, though Murdy and the game on the pack horses, a whitetail, an elk, and a feral cow, weren't all that fragrant either. Something hooted in the woods. They all stiffened, and then relaxed when experienced ears told them it was a real bird. Tuck continued.
"Yeah, monsters. Like the ones who chased our Pamas."
"Ancestors,"
Rudi realized, as they crossed the river where a fallen bridge broke the current and made a ford.
"Out of Chai Town in the bad time. They were just littles, but they was clean, our Pamas. Clean."
In fact, Jake and his friends were a fair bit ranker than the wet heat of summer here demanded, and their ill-cured clothes and harness smelled worse.
not to mention the spatters of sticky, drying blood that they ignored, despite the river being close at hand. Jake explained for the stranger, as Rudi quickly bent and scooped up water and sand in passing to rub his hands free of the sticky mass that threatened to gum his fingers together. He could finish the job later and take care of his sword. Even the finest metal got nicks when you slammed it through bone.
Didn't eat nobody, even when they had to kill them anyhow to keep their own asses off the cook fire. Not even once. The knifers, they still eats man meat sometimes, even when they don't have to. Think it makes them spook strong.
Pride of ancestry rang in his voice, and Rudi gave a little sigh of relief. That spared him the necessity of explaining what was Giza to him, taboo.
And that story would help account for how crude their gear is, Rudi thought. If their parents were mostly children, teenagers at most, themselves. And how much their speech has changed. And if this man is chief, none of the Palmas survived much longer than it took their own children to be three-quarters grown. He's no older than me, I think.
From what he'd heard, most of the folk of the old world had been utterly helpless when the change came and the machines stopped, country folk and farmers only a little less than townsmen. In some places, enough skills had been found or pieced together to build life new on old foundations. The clan Mackenzie had been luckier than most, since many of its founders had been lovers of the ancient arts. Close to the great cities, it had been worst of all. There, tens of millions were left without food or water. Everything went down in a doomed scramble to keep alive an hour at a time, and plague ran through the surging masses like wildfire through dry grass. From the Mississippi to the East Coast, where the cities had been thickest, little remained but bands like these, and Rudi seemed to have been fortunate indeed in the ones he met.
Luck of that sort is only to be expected if you're fated to dree a hero's weird, he thought with an inward grin, half at himself, half defiant mockery at the powers. It's one of the compensations for the fear and danger and general misery and the prospect of an early death. You're lucky until you aren't, so to say.
They was all littles, the Palmas, except old Jake. He was my pa, and Tuck and Samuels, Jake said. He brought everyone out and hid them till the new year. He was a good one, old Jake the sailor man. Dead a long time now, though. He's a good spook.
Spirit guardian, Rudi translated mentally.
For all of us Southside studs and bitches.
Men and women, his mind added.
It was going to be a strain talking until he learned a bit of this dialect. He'd heard many on his trip across the continent, but none quite so strange except those that weren't English at all. They stayed in the river valley for the most part, working their way south and slightly west, despite the deep dark under the trees that blocked most of the moonlight. A little reflected from the rippling surface of the Illinois, enough to use if you were very careful and if the horses were sure-footed. They rode on the verge of the broken pavement to spare their feet, with only the sound of the hooves to mark their passage. Rudi guessed that the Southsider camp was down by the riverbank and wasn't surprised. It would be easier all round, with firewood close to hand, drinking water, cover from prying eyes, and shelter. The higher land around here was mostly open, tall grass prairie. Epona tossed her head and snorted. Rudi inhaled deeply. That was the smell of fires and cooking, and the Swedish rank smell of a camp not strictly kept, wastes and old food and raw hides curing with brains and piss. Evidently, nobody had told these folks about using oak tan bark, despite it being all about them. Garb growled at a chorus of yelping, barking mongrels until a Dane called her sharply to heel. Three more of the Southsider men stepped out from behind trees.
No, Rudi thought, looking at the faces and naked torsos behind the spearheads. One of them is a Southsider woman.
And leveled their weapons, before crying greetings to Jake and wailing at the sight of dead Murdy. More came swarming out to pelt them with questions and beat the curs off with sticks and feet, about 60 of all ages, and they walked in a crowd around the horses until they passed a tiger's skull on a pole and reached the fires and the rough corral.
Say 100 of them in all, half children. 3 more or less grown women for every 2 men or thereabouts,
Rudi thought, making a warrior's quick estimate. Nobody was much older than his new friend, Jake. He doubted more than a handful had been born at the time of the change.
High casualties?
The mob gazed gape-jawed at Rudi and a Dane in their strange gear, pointing and gabbling in a way Mackenzie's would think rude. Rudi sat his great black horse with a long-limbed grace, the bright red-gold hair falling to his shoulders, and his sharp-cut, high-cheeked face smiling. A Dane was less easy, his strong, square face blank. He wouldn't ask Rudi, "Are you sure?" with strangers about. None of the Southsiders matched Rudy's height, and none had his companion's breadth of shoulder or barrel chest.
Not a prepossessing lot, but truly friendly, I think.
Rudi winked at a naked toddler with a huge mop of frizzy hair. She ducked behind her mother, herself a girl of no more than 16 years, who cradled a baby on her hip.
"Let these studs have room," Jake called. "They saves our asses, truth, and lay on eats. We got Murdy to bury and our new friends to show our right and good ways."
When the mob surged back towards the camp, Jake went on quietly.
"And when we've had the eats, you can tell me more of that story of yours. We don't like the Iowa motherfuckers or their boss men at all. Shoved our palmas back into this shit with their pitchforks. Keep us here still."
Rudi nodded gravely. A Dane thought a little, since he too had little use for Iowa's ruler and liked the whole place less than the older Mackenzie. The Iowa folk had closed the Mississippi bridges in the chaotic months after the change and patrolled the western shore, or they'd have been buried beneath the tidal wave of refugees heading west from Chicago and the other lakeside cities and north from St. Louis.
"Though now they've more land than they can till," he thought,
remembering pasture where fields had once been. "And at that, more grass than the cattle could eat down.
They could change their policy, if they would, and both would benefit by it."
There was a hungry smile in Jake's words.
"Anyone's got a hate against that boss man bastard, he's got a word to say here."
"Sure, and I'd not weep if he were to be done an injury," Rudi said. "He's not the worst ruler I've ever met, but he's far from the best. And not the smartest either, that he is not."
"The smartest of rulers? A toss-up between my mother and Matty's? That would be the one wise and good. The other, wise and wicked."
He realized with a start that he missed Matilda's mother. Missed her counsel and her peculiar way of looking at the world. They'd always gotten on well enough, even when he'd been her husband's captive during the War of the Eye. But then again, you never really knew where you stood with the spider of the Silver Tower. He did know she loved Matilda.
"I've never really understood her otherwise. She's a bad person, really, but she's raised Matty to be a good one, and she was always kind to me, even when she pushed me hard to learn and grow. She's done great evil, but great good also, if more from policy than inclination. And I think that the good will long outlive her, while the evil will mostly vanish. Start to vanish, at least, when Matty takes the throne of Portland and rules the association. And the more I travel, the more I realize I've learned from her those months every year I lived in the regent's household. Things I never could have learned at home. Mother has true wisdom, but it's not all the wisdom there is. What she stands for is good, but some things can't be seen from where she stands."
And that was something he could only realize at a distance from them both, as if the knowledge unfolded with the weight of their personalities removed for a while, letting it open like a flower from the bud.
"And at home, I would never have realized what I knew,"
he mused, looking westward to where stars shone over the treetops.
"Nor learned what I have from others on this journey." "Am I journeying to the east, then? or do I travel towards myself? When I meet the man I am becoming? Who will Rudi Mackenzie be in himself? He mused. Will those I know me still? One thing I do know. I'll rescue Matty for her own sweet sake. But even if she wasn't dear to me, I'd be downright terrified of failing Lady Sandra Arminger.
Chapter 2. Barony of Ath, Portland Protective Association. Tulatin Valley, Oregon. August 15th, change year 24, 2022 AD. The Lord High Chancellor and the Grand Constable of the PPA rode side by side through the harvested field, with their hawks on their wrists and the attendants at a discreet distance behind. A covey of pheasants exploded from the ground ahead of their horses in a cracking flutter of wings. Both the associates were in what Portlander fashion decreed for gentlemen engaged in rural pleasures on a summer's day. Turned-down thigh boots with the golden spurs of knighthood on the heels, doe-skin breeches, baggy-sleeved linen shirts beneath long tea-tunics cinched by broad sword-belts of studded and tooled leather, and wraparound sunglasses in gilded frames. Embroidered heraldic shields on their chests showed their arms. Those of Chancellor Conrad Renfrew, also Count of Odell, were sable, a snow-topped mountain argent on vert. It echoed the towering perfect cone of Mount Hood, just visible as a tiny silver spike on the eastern horizon. Baroness Tephane Dath bore sable, a delta or over a V argent. She wore a discreet livery badge at the brow of her hat as well, her own arms quartered with Sandra Arminger's in token of vassalage.
"Your turn,"
the Count of Odell said, nodding towards the pheasants skimming over the ground.
"Thanks, Conrad," Tephane said.
This was one of the five great fields of her manor at Montenor, and the 300 acres of brown, blonde wheat stubble with clover pushing up below provided plenty of cover. The ring of hawthorn hedge and wide-spaced poplars around it were full of good places for nesting, and even conscientious gleaners didn't get all the fallen grain that attracted quarry.
"Three get you five, that cock pheasant makes it to the hedge," the older noble said.
The big black-gray peregrine on her wrist crouched and baited with a bristle of feathers as she slipped free the hood, and a faint sweet ring from the silver bells on its buet straps as the talons closed and relaxed in anticipation. It knew what the sudden coming of the light meant. Then, its mad slit pupil yellow eyes flared dark as they fixed themselves on the prey. She could feel the strength of its grip on her wrist through the thick leather of the glove.
"Done," Tephane replied. "Go for it, riot girl."
She tossed the arm up in a quick throwing arc, and the bird flung itself skyward, soaring upward in a widening gyre with a harsh, "Scree, scree, scree!" The wind of long, graceful wings was cool on her cheek and neck for an instant, in the mild, dry warmth of a Willamette summer's day. The covey's alarm suddenly turned panic-stricken as the incarnate shadow of deep ancestral fear fell across them. They scattered, spattering away like water popping on a hot griddle. Frenzied, the male pheasant tried to outrace the circling doom rather than going for cover, its long tail feathers streaming as he strove for height.
"Stop taking the air, you idiot," the Count of Odell said sourly. "She's twice as fast as you are."
Tephane watched the dance of life and death in the cloudless blue above, with eyes the color of moonlit glaciers, and smiled with a very slight curve of the lips. It made everything seem more intense for a moment, from the feel of the great muscles moving between her thighs to the smells of equine sweat and oiled leather, sweet crushed clover and dry, dusty earth.
"That's a lovely falcon you've got there," Conrad said, following the flight of the peregrine. "And she's going to cost me some money, dammit. Alaskan?"
She nodded.
"Aleutian."
"Must have cost you," he said.
Trade was sparse from those remote islands, and had to run the gauntlet of Haida pirates and the Queen Charlotte's in the Inland Passage. Only the most expensive luxury goods could bear the costs.
"Worth it," she replied. "Northern birds always fly better, especially in Yarrick."
The association nobles reined in and watched the falcon climb. The bird sitting hooded on Conrad Renfrew's wrist was a big, dark brown, muse-bred Harris hawk with chestnut shoulders and white banding on the base and tip of its tail. It had already taken two rabbits and a duck today, despite which...
"It's hardly falconry at all with a Harris," Tephain thought.
She privately considered that species to be like Irish setters with feathers and talons. Unlike pretty well all other birds of prey, they were social hunters, coursing in flocks in the wild, and they were affectionate to their handlers in ways other breeds just weren't. That, and the ease with which they could be bred in captivity, made them favorites.
"They do everything but lick your hand and lift a leg to pee."
"You've got a good eye for a falcon," he admitted.
"I always did identify with predators. Back before the change."
Conrad had been over 30 then. She'd been 14. They'd both survived the first change year, when the vast majority of the human race had not, but the experience divided as much as it linked them. His generation were of the old world. Those a few years younger than she were changelings. She hung between.
"My bedroom was plastered with pictures of hawks and wolves and tigers and leopards."
The Count of Odell's hideously scarred face quirked in a smile.
"Isn't it usually horses with girls that age?"
"Usually. I preferred things with fangs or claws, or both."
"Why am I not surprised, Lady Death?"
he said, using the common pun on her title.
"Well, I had a Melissa Etheridge poster on the wall, too."
"Who? Oh, she was a musician, right? I think I've heard you do some of her stuff now and then."
"Right. Serious crush on her at the time."
That had been an eventful spring. She turned 14 in January, met Katrina Georges in February when the other girl transferred to Binsmead Middle School, won a medal at the Oak Ridge Gymnastics Meet at the beginning of March, and then, on the 17th, the world had ended at 6:15 p.m. Pacific Time.
"Birthday, first love, victory. Then the laws of nature change while you're on a camping trip. Killed my first man 5 days later and couldn't believe how easy it was. But I do miss CDs and my Walkman sometimes. Calling for the minstrel just isn't the same."
The thought was odd. It had been a long time since she remembered the change much, or thought of herself as Colette Rutherton rather than the name Sandra had chosen for her when she became an associate of the PPA. Conrad's generation always had one mental foot planted in the old world, however hard they tried to pull it out or deny it. Hers remembered it, but as though seen faded through multiple panes of glass, except on the rare occasions when it came flooding back to make the now seem like a mad dream for an instant. To those a few years younger, the changelings, it was a fable.
"And I envy them that. Envy them and fear it a little. Even Delia. I love her, but I don't understand her sometimes. The kids are even worse. They don't just take this world we've made naturally. They think, but they don't think about thinking the way I do sometimes, and Conrad and Sandra and the other oldsters do all the time. The changelings, it's like they're in a dream. So am I, but I know it. They never wake up or know they're dreaming."
"Ah," Tephain said, pulling off her tinted glasses and shading her eyes with the hand that held them. A second later, Conrad pushed his mirror shades up onto the bald dome of his head and muttered something under his breath. Probably, "damn," as the falcon selected the cock pheasant's gaudy, golden-green plumage for its target. The peregrine stooped out of the sun, folding its wings and turning itself into a blurred streak of purpose. There was a faint thud from the air above, a puff of feathers against the bright afternoon sky.
"She binds,"
Tiffane said, and didn't add,
"I win."
The two birds spun groundward, locked together by the attacker's talons. They struck with a thump on the wheat stubble not far away. The peregrine shrieked its triumph and its rage, mantling and darting its ripping beak downward with cruel precision. Everyone cantered over and pulled up. The falconer dismounted and whirled its feathered lure on the end of its cord with a rattling hum. The bird cocked an eye at it and jumped, then consented to be hooded again and fed from the hand. Varlets picked up the pheasant and added it to the basket, giving the neck a quick twist to make sure.
"That's enough for verisimilitude," Conrad said with a sigh. "Duty calls, and so does lunch."
Tiffane nodded and turned her horse. They heeled their mounts into a faster pace towards the little unwalled pavilion where the others waited. Conrad looked around at the stubble field.
"Nice work," he said. "You can hardly see where the individual strips are."
Montanore Manor operated on the usual PPA system. The peasant families each held scattered strips in all of the five fields, and the crops, winter wheat, spring oats, and roots like turnips or potatoes, grass and clover for fodder, were rotated through the fields in turn. Back in the early days, the semi-communal arrangement had let a few real farmers supervise hordes of refugee suburbanites who'd never before done anything more rural than curse the dandelions on their lawns. Nowadays, it made it easy for the manor lord to exact his share of the crop and labor service on the domain. Tiffane shrugged.
"I've got good reeves on my estates and a first-rate seneschal," she said, "and Delia keeps them from dipping the till while I'm away, which is too often. I like living here, and to hell with Portland and Castle Todenoxt. I'm sick of spending my days in armor. Being Sandra's assassin and duelist was fun, but Grand Constable is just work. Damn the Prophet. Damn the United States of Boise, and damn this war, too."
"Now you know why I was so glad to unload the job on you."
Conrad shrugged in turn.
"Be glad you've got a nice defensive war you can really get your teeth into. We'd likely be fighting about now, even if Boise and Corwin hadn't gotten big eyes. Sandra hasn't had to spend the last decade and change building castles and saving up money and training troops for nothing."
Tiffane sighed.
"You're right, of course. She's not any less ambitious than Norman was, just a hell of a lot more patient and sneaky. Oh well, she's the sovereign."
"Until Matilda comes of age,"
Conrad said, and grinned like the ornament on a cathedral waterspout.
"That's going to be interesting."
"Then it'll be the changeling's turn. I suspect by then a lot of things will be different."
They drew rein near the pavilion, under the branches of the great Gary oak that shaded it. Tiffane returned the salute of the guard captain with a curt nod and a lift of her riding crop.
"Sir Lothair?"
He wore half-armor, like the 20 mounted crossbowmen, and a peaked montero cap with a long, curling feather at one side, what she'd have called a Robin Hood hat in her youth. The dozen lancers nearby were in full fig, armored cap-a-pie on barded destriers, blazing steel statues with their visors down and eyes invisible behind the narrow vision slits. The men-at-arms would be feeling like buns in a bake oven right now, combined with a sauna. She'd experienced it often enough, and would again, unless the enemy were civilized enough to fight only in cool weather.
"Though, oddly enough, when the weather's really cold, full armor doesn't give you any warmth at all."
"My Lady Grand Constable,"
he said after a moment's scrutiny for form's sake.
"My Lord Chancellor, you are recognized and may pass."
Grooms took the horses as they dismounted, and the hunt servants brought up their count of pheasant and duck, quail and rabbit, for the semi-ritual inspection.
"They are indeed very dead,"
Tiffane thought with a trace of whimsy as she looked at the limp, bloodied forms and prodded one with a gloved finger.
"And someone should eat them very soon in this warm weather."
She went on aloud as Conrad handed his hawk and perching glove to his falconer.
"The game to good Father Mendoza, with my compliments."
She nodded towards the steeple of the village church a mile westward across the great common field, rising above trees and red-tiled roofs, with the coast range green-blue beyond it. They'd give the parish priest, his household, and some of the ill or indigent a couple of good dinners. Slyly,
"And tell him that my lord, the Count of Odell, has graciously donated 5 rose nobles for the almshouse fund."
"Gold? I didn't say anything about 3 get you 5 in gold,"
Conrad said, alarmed. That was a month's wage for a mounted man-at-arms.
"Even for someone who started out as an accountant, you are such a cheapskate, Conrad. You've got the whole Hood River Valley in your fee, for God's sake, and 2 toll bridges, and a chartered town to tax. I'm a lowly baroness with a few manors. Show some class."
She stripped off her gauntlet and held it out. He unwillingly dropped the little dime-sized coins inside. She folded the long cuff over and into the wrist, then tossed it into the game basket.
"Go,"
she said.
The varlet gulped thankfully and jogged away. Listening to the higher nobility exchanging badinage wasn't comfortable for someone that low on the food chain, though it would probably make excellent gossip at the village taverns, crowded as they were with the entourages of the visitors. The pavilion was Sandra's, and hence in exquisite taste. Heavy oiled silk striped white and blue on a hidden framework of galvanized poles. Bullion tassels all around the edges were woven with glass strips that chimed lightly when they touched. Rugs covered the ground, glowing with designs of flowers and vines in wine red and green and blue. A light folding table and chairs of carved reddish wood stood within. It was quite private, and even the men-at-arms and crossbowmen of the Protector's Guard were at a discreet distance. Tiphaine removed her round, roll-brimmed noble's hat with a broad trailing tail and joined Conrad in 2 elaborate leg- and hand-flourish bows to the pair of noblewomen within. One was Delia de Stafford, blue-eyed and black-haired and delicately beautiful, and 30 to her own 38, and dressed in a daring new mode she'd pioneered for semi-formal occasions away from court. It was based on what commoner women wore. A long, light undertunic and knee-length overtunic, but with gauzy silks and lots of lace making it a fantasy in white and lavender instead of utilitarian plainness. A belt of old woven gold held a jewel-hilted ceremonial dagger to show that she was an associate, and the equally symbolic ring of silver keys that marked her as chatelaine of Barony Doth. The other was Sandra Arminger, Lady Regent of the PPA, in a conservative pearl gray and white cotehardie and a silk headdress confined in a net of platinum and diamonds. To her, Tiphaine and Conrad added a bend of the right knee that touched the carpet for an instant.
"Although technically I should curtsy," she thought. "It looks ridiculous in pants, though." "My liege lady and regent," she said, and "my lady Delia. If you two are finally finished slaughtering harmless birds and quite small animals, we can get to work," Sandra Arminger said.
She folded the weekly trumpet she'd been reading. It was turned either to the crossword puzzle or to an article headlined, "Feudalism, God's Will or Just Common Sense?" and tossed the newspaper on top of 2 illustrated magazines, Tournaments Illuminated and the Associates Town and Castle Journal. Then she extended her hand to both of them in turn for the ritual kiss of homage.
"The social cover story for this is a bit of hawking," Conrad of Odell pointed out. "It helps to actually do some hawking."
Tiphaine nodded, standing hip-shot at cat-like ease with her left hand on the hilt of her longsword. A falconry party was something you could invite only chosen people to without offending anyone, or at least without giving them a formal reason to be offended, as exclusion from a council meeting would, even if everyone knew it was really a political conclave before the council.
"Though we'll miss the boar hunting this year with the war,"
she said with a sigh, looking westward. Montanore Village was in the foreground, just across the road and railway that led south to Newburgh. Beyond that was the White Manor House, the fields and hilly vineyards and orchards of her domain, and then the stark square tower and walls of Castle Ath on its height, ferro concrete covered in pale stucco, like a fortress in a picture book, with banners streaming from the turrets. After that started the great forests of the Coast Range, mile after mile of quiet umber shade. She thought of the quick belling of hounds through the glades in the chill October air, and the quarry at bay beneath a half-fallen fir tree. "Fighting with pigs," Sandra said, sipping at a glass of scented herbal tisane that tinkled with ice. "In freezing mud, while it's raining. This is recreation?"
"It's not quite as much fun as hot, sweaty sex," Conrad acknowledged. "But in the right season, you could do it more often. Or at least for longer."
"Speak for yourself, Odell," Tophane said with an expression that had the shadow of a wolf's grin behind it. "Not all of us have your limitations."
Delia smothered a chuckle, and Sandra sighed.
"Children, children." "Oh, sit down, Tiff," she went on, tucking a lock of graying brown hair back under her wimple. "You do tend to loom over one. My Lady Regent is a dimensionally challenged person," Tophane said.
Sandra was 5'2" and still slight in her 54th year.
"I was 14 when you took me and Cat into the household, and I was already taller than you. I can't help looming."
"You can't help being a big blonde horse of a woman, you mean, Doth," Conrad said. "That's why you'd never have made it to the Olympics."
She nodded, although she had a whipcord and steel length of limb that made her look quite slender at first glance. The Olympics had been her dream before the change, but...
"But in fact, I was already too tall and still growing. Gymnasts were all munchkins, like muscular little steroidal pixies. I'd have ended up a phys ed teacher or a girls' basketball coach or something. Or maybe if I'd switched to track and field."
"Whereas I just cast a welcome shade," Conrad continued smugly, slapping dust off his blocky torso.
His chair creaked a little as he sat. The chancellor of the Portland Protective Association was no taller than Tophane, around 5'10", but he'd always been shaped like a fireplug made of bone and muscle. Now that he was past 50 and not taking the field anymore, he'd added some solid flesh to that, and he grunted with relief as he sat, running one spatulate hand over the shaven dome of his bullet-shaped head.
"That's one way of saying, I'm getting fat, Odell."
Tophane sat with more than her usual leopard grace and crossed ankle over knee. Conrad grunted again as he reached to take a handful of shelled hazelnuts and walnuts from a Venetian glass bowl on the table, salvage from some museum.
"You too shall be in your 50s sometime, my lady grand constable," he said, tossing one of the nut meats into his mouth. "In precisely 12 years, in fact."
"Possibly, my lord chancellor," Tophane said, "in the unlikely event someone doesn't kill me first. But I don't think the years shall weigh quite so heavily on me as they do on you."
Conrad's facial nightmare of thick, white keloid scars made his laugh even more alarming than that gravelly sound would have been otherwise. A steward with a white tabard and ivory baton made a gesture, and two pages brought trays from the other, much plainer, tent, 20 yards away. They set out a platter of sandwiches, petit fours, and chilled Pinot Grigio wine with seltzer, and waited, demure in their black livery of silk hose and PowerPoint jackets embroidered with the Doth arms, curl-toed shoes of gilded leather cutwork, and fez-like brimless hats.
"Your sons make such charming and efficient pages, Lady Delia," Sandra Arminger said, "with such large, pink, shell-like, quivering ears."
Delia took the hint.
"Lioncel, Diomede," she said, and made a graceful gesture.
The boys... Blonde Lioncel was 12, Dark Diomede, 2 years younger, bowed in unison and walked backward until the distance was outside easy hearing, even with keen young ears. Tophane took a sandwich. The PPA's liege lady Sandra and Tophane's lady-in-waiting and chatelaine Delia,
my girlfriend for the last 14 years, Delia,
Tophane thought, with a familiar flicker of resentment at the necessity for discretion.
Best not to get out of the habit of being careful, though.
Shared a liking for dainty little things on manchet bread, with the crusts cut off, and some parsley on the side. In this case, potted shrimp and aspic, deviled ham with minced sweet Walla Walla onions, or cucumber. Since this was to Fane's own personal fief, there were also some substantial examples of bacon, lettuce, and tomato with mayo on sourdough. She smiled a little as she bit into one, savoring the smoky taste of the apple-cured meat and fresh, melting ripe tomatoes and almost warm, crusty bread.
"What's the joke, darling?"
Delia asked. They'd been together since Cat died in the Protector's War, and she knew that slight curve of Tophane's lips was the equivalent of a grin or even a chortle. The Baroness shrugged, swallowed, blotted her lips with a linen napkin and said,
"A pleasant memory. The only pleasant memory our unlamented pseudo-Pope Leo ever gave me, but it made up for all the rest."
These days, the local branch of the reunified church was just annoying to someone like her, guarded by rank and powerful patronage. She pretended to be a good Catholic with sardonic relish, and with gritted teeth, the clergy pretended to believe her. Delia did the same, and was a secret witch to boot and high priestess of a coven. But Norman Arminger had been literally medieval on the subject of gay people, as on much else, and his psychopathic pet, Pope Leo, had been worse. About the time her husband died, Sandra Arminger had found out that the real Catholic Church had survived. A remnant had fled dying Rome behind the halberds of the Swiss Guard and ended up in the little Umbrian hill town of Baggio, still their HQ, and that they'd managed to call a conclave to elect an equally real pope. To lay the groundwork for reunion, the Lady Regent had delegated Schismatic Leo's tragic, timely, and officially accidental demise to Tophane, who'd been her wetwork specialist of choice back then.
"One sane pope half the world away by sailing ship is much less trouble than a deranged one right next door," Sandra acknowledged. "We needed our own church immediately after the change, but by that time Leo was a problem."
Tophane's smile grew a little wider. Sandra was fond of an old Russian saying, "When a man causes you a problem, remember, no man, no problem." The recollection of the look on his starved eagle ascetic face when he saw her step silently from behind an arras in his private chambers and hold up the hypodermic.
"I smiled then, too," she thought, happily nostalgic. "That was a good day. We did a lot of house cleaning around then."
Ah, if tombstones were only honest, how many would read, "Died of being an inconvenience to the powerful,"
Conrad said genially. He was obviously following at least some of her thoughts. Delia winced slightly, for the same reason. She was a gentle soul. "It's not as if it were a personal impulse," Tophane said, mildly defensive. "As the Lady Regent said, the man needed killing."
"And you certainly didn't leave muddy footprints all over the place,"
Conrad said admiringly.
"Very neat. Until just now, I actually thought there was an outside chance it was really natural causes."
"I don't screw up, and I had a left de cachet with me just in case, anyway," she pointed out.
Sandra smiled, with a faraway, reminiscent expression of her own.
"The bearer has done what has been done by my authority, and for the good of the state. I always loved actually writing that, milady."
"Tiff never have one stolen by a dashing Gascon musketeer, either," the Count of Odell said. "And God knows she had enough of them pass through her hands. Or did you just use the first and not bother having a fresh one made up for every job, Doth?"
"No, a new letter every time.
I've still got all the old ones, stamped cancelled in red ink.
You're joking, right?
Delia shuddered and rolled her eyes.
No, she isn't. A whole file of them, all on parchment and all tied up with ribbons.
That's sort of sick, you know, the Count of Odell laughed.
We all have our hobbies, Conrad, Tiphaine said, pouring herself a glass of the fizzy white wine and taking a sip that tasted of flowers and almonds and oranges. The regent has her cats. You and Lady Odell are always on about those roses of yours. Delia loves babies.
Sandra turned to Delia and asked politely,
And how is little Hurades?
The younger woman brightened.
Teething, poor lamb, my lady, but...
She caught Tiphaine's eye and abbreviated the details to,
Still cute as a button.
Oh, cute as a puppy, Tiphaine agreed. She's going to be fair, like Lionsel.
And this is the last one.
Three was a smallish family these days, and Delia had wanted to try again for another daughter to balance the set, but...
We're retiring that turkey baster if I have anything to say about it. Which, admittedly, I may not. However, babies are much harder to housebreak, she finished. Plus, puppies don't need to be found dowries or fiefs when they grow up.
And on that note, Sandra said more seriously, what do you make of the situation? Not the details, the larger picture.
As always, she was in combinations of gray and white, with silver gilt buttons down the sleeves and bodice of her cotehardie. A Persian kitten rested in a small basket on her lap and dodged a paw out of the dangling trails of the wimple now and then.
The enemy are still not pressing us very hard, she added, reaching in a hand and running a finger down its head.
The little beast turned on its back and began to wrestle with the digit as she tickled its stomach.
I expected them to be more aggressive.
The dance starts soon, Tiphaine said, and went into the details.
Conrad nodded agreement when she'd finished.
It's a persisting strategy. Subtle for an alliance. The sum total of a whole lot of little fights is more predictable than one or two big ones where luck and generalship can overcome the odds.
Unlike the other noble, Tiphaine reached for a second sandwich.
Benefits of an active metabolism, she thought, as she marshaled reports and observations in her mind. Perks of running around wearing 60 pounds of steel half the time. Also, good food makes me feel less pessimistic.
Sandra pursed her lips and tapped a finger on them.
I'm surprised our enemies are being so far-sighted. They're both young men. Prophet Sathaz is barely 30, and General President Martin Thurston of Boise is younger still. In my experience, patient isn't a quality of which men that age show any great fund. Sathaz is... I'm not sure if he's altogether human, Tiphaine said. He's certainly mad, and I wouldn't rule out the stories of demonic possession.
Conrad grunted agreement. Sandra raised one elegant brow. Her brown eyes were a little surprised.
Et tu, Tiphaine?
I've had too much contact with the cut to doubt that something very strange is going on out there in the Valley of Paradise, she said. Strange and unpleasant. You taught me to evaluate the evidence, my lady, not reject it because it conflicted with my assumptions. And you heard about Lady Astrid's headache?
Sandra's brow went up.
That was supernatural, she said.
Conrad snorted.
Damn straight it was. I've seen Tiff draw, spun 180 degrees, cut a dragonfly in half on the wing, sheathe the blade and be back where she started in about a second, he said. Astrid's just as good.
Just as fast, certainly, Tiphaine said, with hard-won professional detachment.
The hero Dunedain had killed her lover Katrina during the Protector's War in the course of the botched first attempt to get Matilda back from the Mackenzies. Tiphaine didn't dwell on the memory. It was too stressful.
Stress is mostly the result of not being allowed to kill some asshole you really want to slice and dice.
Something is going on, Conrad said grimly, and I lost my belief in the absolute reign of impersonal natural laws about 24 years ago. There's something else at work in the universe. and it doesn't seem to like us much.
A point, Sandra said reluctantly. She was that rarity these days, an atheist to the core, a complete materialist and rationalist. Tophane had been one herself until recently, though they were both pious enough in public. As Sandra said, God was a myth, but religion was as real as rocks and far more useful to rulers.
Now I'm not sure anymore, Tophane thought. I'm still not sure about God, that is, but the devil is starting to look awfully convincing. I'm going to have a talk with Delia about aligning with some protective spook or other, even if I'd rather pull out my own toenails with my teeth.
She went on aloud, her voice coolly neutral.
And Thurston is just too smart for comfort. He is having riverboats built in Pendleton, with the locals and the Cut supplying materials. So Thaz lets him do that. The Cutters have those religious taboos about machinery, but as long as we hold the castles and walled cities along the Columbia, we can strike north or south at the flank of any invader, and we have superior water transport for our logistics. Clear enough, then. Let's not get bogged down in military details at this point, Sandra said. I'll leave that to you, my Lady Grand Constable, and to the Chancellor. What's the state of morale, Conrad? She went on.
The thick-bodied man looked at the wine glass in his hand and said grudgingly,
Uneven. The older nobles are being effusively loyal, and will stay that way as long as we keep the enemy outside our boundaries. If they get inside, and it looks profitable to start cutting deals...
He shrugged, and Tophane mentally followed suit. Norman Arminger had built a feudal kingdom, albeit a strong one. His personal obsession had been the 11th-century Norman duchy and its offshoots. Homegrown varieties of neo-feudalism without the PPA's elaborate organization and terminology.
Or our spiffy boots and radical cool costumes, she thought,
were certainly common in other areas of the continent, and evidently overseas as well. But
while loyalty is the great feudal virtue, unfortunately, treachery is the corresponding vice,
Tophane thought. History had been a compulsory subject in Sandra's household,
and the older generation had to learn about loyalty, while treachery was something they already knew very, very well indeed. All those gangers.
Sandra had never pretended to be any sort of soldier, and generally didn't try to joggle her subordinates' elbows, unlike her husband's practice. At politics, however,
I've looked over the list of tenants-in-chief you want to summon to the muster, the Lady Regent went on. It's approved, with the following modifications.
She reached into an attaché case on the ground beside her and slid the typewritten schedules to them. Tophane took hers, and her eyebrows went up. Tenants-in-chief held their land directly from the throne on payment of main tithes, a share of their income, and service of knights, men-at-arms, and foot soldiers of set number and equipment on demand. Part of the Grand Constable's job was to see the troops were ready and call them up at need. The total numbers here were the same as her recommendations for the opening stages of the campaigning season, but some of those summoned were awkwardly placed. Then she smiled thinly as the reasoning sprang out at her. The initial levies of House Stavarov, the Counts of Chehalis up near Puget Sound, were summoned for the war in the east and the rally point at Walla Walla. The Counts themselves, their meini of household knights and paid men-at-arms, spearmen and crossbowmen, their castle garrisons, their sub-infeudated vassals, and their meinis. The third string, the peasant militia and town levies, were detached for service under the warden of the coast march against the nuisance verging on threat of Haida raiders, which meant... Conrad spoke first.
Ah, Uriah the Hittite, my lady.
If there's anyone who would change sides when a Cutter army arrived in front of his castle gates, it's Count Pyotr Alexeyevich Stavarov. I've nearly killed Pyotr at least 3 times, Tophane said meditatively. Isn't there a saying that it's the things you didn't do that you regret at the end of your life? And Conrad's not looking too upset. He had that run-in with Piotr during the Protector's War, when the idiot got half his command killed trying to rush a bunch of Mackenzies head-on. There's still bad blood there.
No, no, Sandra said. I'm not telling you to get them killed. We need every man, from what you and Lady Darth say. But if men must die, why not men from the meini of County Chehalis? They do their duty, and the Stavarovs are weakened.
She held two small, beautifully manicured hands out palm up and mimicked a balance, raising first one and then the other. The Grand Constable nodded.
I can make the adjustments easily enough, my lady, she said. The logistics are a little more difficult, but not enough to matter.
The younger nobles are eager for a fight,
Conrad went on, and Tophane nodded silent agreement.
Ordinary people are frightened, my lady regent, Delia said, a frown on her oval face as she joined the conversation.
She'd been a miller's daughter here in Montanore Village before she met Tophane. When it came to how the commons thought, she had a better instinctive grasp than any of them, despite all the regent's spies. Sandra and Conrad Renfrew had been founders of the association, of course, and Tophane had been raised as an associate. Delia went on.
They're nearly as frightened of having the throne weakened and the nobles unrestrained if we lose as they are of Boise and the Cut. What's helping a lot is the stories and songs about Princess Matilda and Rudi and the rest, particularly with the younger people.
She was near as no matter a changeling, too, which helped. Tophane had noticed that the older generation tended to miss things, and she did too, albeit less often.
Ah, yes, Sandra murmured with a secret smile. How helpful of dear Juniper to compose and spread them. Between her and the church preaching a holy war, we're well covered on the propaganda front. I've never seen you so openly furious as you were when you found out Matilda had scooted off east with Rudi, Tophane thought. I actually had to talk you out of sending the army bearing off eastward to drag her back. But trust the spider of the Silver Tower to adjust and see the advantages.
My lady, I think you're underestimating the impact of these songs that are going the rounds, Tophane warned. As Delia said, the same technique is more effective nowadays, since so many more are changelings.
Yes, it's convenient right now, but it will have political consequences after the war, too, provided we win, that is. Ignoring Mackenzie propaganda hurt us badly in the Protector's War. Sandra frowned. She'd known her husband's weaknesses, but...
But then she actually loved him, Tophane thought.
She'd hated Norman Arminger herself, and feared him as she feared few men.
Loved him despite his screwing everything that moved and shaking what didn't, and his general skankiness. Leaving aside the mass murder and so forth, that was just business, though he enjoyed it.
The latest, this vision of the Virgin telling Father Ignatius to look after Matilda, Sandra said, I like that one very much indeed. It makes anyone who challenges her rights a blasphemer. And the cream of the jest is that Ignatius probably believes it himself. Everyone knows the Order of the Shield of St. Benedict is outside our influence. Mount Angel is cool to the Protectorate at best. They fought us in the war, after all.
The princess was already popular, Delia said. Everyone who met her liked her. The commons love her. They,
look forward to her rule, Sandra nodded, with a wry twist to her mouth.
Tophane could read her thought.
And they'll never love me.
Respect and fear, yes. The smarter ones realized how she held the barons in check. But love, no. Too many memories of the early days remained raw among the ordinary people. And for different reasons, among the associates as well. Norman Arminger had taken Machiavelli's dictum that it was better for a ruler to be feared than loved, rather literally.
This quest thing, it's made her more like an icon, Delia continued.
She hesitated again.
Rudi, too. The Sword of the Lady. It's not just the people who follow the old religion. The rest think of the Virgin, you see. and Ignatius's vision added to that. They think Rudi is the hero who returns, the one who comes back to save his people when the evil day arrives and things look their worst.
Sandra chuckled, a gurgling sound that made her cool brown eyes warm for a moment.
Certainly, dear Rudi has all the qualifications for a legendary hero. He's very young, and he's very handsome, and he's very strong, and he's very brave, and he's very... not stupid.
For some reason, Conrad thought that was funny, too, though she couldn't see why. It was all true. He sobered quickly, though.
It's good that the stories are perking the ordinary people up, he said. Even with our allies, we can't win this war just with the nobility and their retainers. It's going to be too big for the associates to handle. But what happens? Well, my lady, what happens if Rudi and Matilda don't show up?
Sandra was very quiet for a moment.
If Matilda is killed, then it's all rather moot.
Softly.
What have I worked for, if not for her?
Chapter 3. Des Moines, Capital, Provisional Republic of Iowa. Bossman's House, August 20th, Change Year 24, 2022 AD.
So, you're really a princess?
Kate Heaselrode said, her pink young face wide-eyed and guileless.
I mean, they call you that?
Yes, I'm entitled Princess and styled Your Highness at home. My mother's the Lady Regent,
Matilda Arminger explained to the boss man's consort.
She must be at least 20, she thought, and I'm only 2 years older, but it feels like more. I think she led a sheltered life, until recently at least.
Aloud.
But I inherit through my father, Lord Norman Arminger, whose only child I am. He was our first sovereign lord, Lord Protector of the Portland Protective Association. He was a knight before the change, of course, in the society, as well as a great scholar of the old ways at the university.
The other woman made a fascinated sound and inclined her head towards a painfully young man in a military uniform that involved a good deal of braid and a gold lanyard.
Something for me and the princess, please, Lieutenant. At once, Mrs. Heaselrode.
The aide sprang away towards the buffet and the bar.
It's all just homelike enough to make me homesick, but not enough to comfort, Matilda thought, as she schooled her face to friendly interest. Not that it's hard to be friendly. It's brief acquaintance, but I find I do like Kate.
A burbling surf of conversation rose to the carved plaster of the ceiling 2 stories above. More guests leaned on the balustrade that ringed the reception room. Heels clicked on the marble tiles and on the curving staircase that linked the levels. The boss man's household troops, they called them the state police, stood at attention along the walls amid framed pictures and half columns, their burnished mail shirts and helms glittering in the brilliance of the incandescent mantles of the gaslights, along with the crowd's crystal and gold and diamonds, fine cloth and polished leather. Open French doors brought an occasional waft of cooler air from the gardens and the scents of roses and cut grass, along with the odd suicide-bent moth.
So everyone says, Your Highness? Kate said, returning to the subject that fascinated her.
Yes,
Matilda Arminger said with a practiced smile. There were people at home obsessed with protocol, too.
Quite a few of them, in fact.
The aide came back, and she took a plate of what her mother called faculty fodder, for some obscure pre-change reason. Little pieces of toast with shaved ham and pungent cheese, or bits of pickled fish, or tiny sausages and capers and pâté, or peppers and sweet corn. A glass of some fizzy drink called sarsaparilla came with it.
I'm not Princess Regent or Lady Protector yet, of course. Not until I'm 26. Then I'll be styled Your Majesty.
Kate laughed.
And everyone will have to go down on their knees?
Only one, until then. And only at ceremonies, of course. Receiving homage, bestowing fiefs, that sort of thing. We're less formal most of the time.
Is there a book of rules or something? Well, the College of Heralds have their lists, but really, if you grow up around it, it's all sort of natural. It sounds like fun, really, like a costume party.
Not if it's your life, Matilda thought. Mother complains about it sometimes. Of course, for her, before the change, it was a game. Sometimes I think it still is, and she can't help it. People that old, it's as if they were always watching themselves live their lives instead of just living them and being themselves. Weird.
An inspiration came to her.
You're a princess too, my dear Kate.
At the other woman's laugh, she went on.
No, truly. You're the lawful consort of a ruling prince, after all. Unless it would be more accurate to call him a king. In which case you'd be queen, of course, and your children would be princes and princesses. There's only little Tommy so far, Kate said.
For a moment, her face was soft with love and went from strikingly pretty to beautiful.
And he's my prince. Then you're definitely a princess at the very least.
She made a dismissive gesture, but Matilda could see the corners of her mouth turn up in pleasure. She could also see half a dozen others in the big room noting the exchange as they milled around. The biggest knot was around Anthony Heaselroad, of course, the boss man of Iowa. Governor and President pro tem, formally, but that was the word everyone used in ordinary speech. She could just hear him saying,
"Keep the great agricultural industry of Iowa in responsible, experienced hands for the common good of farmer and evacuee alike."
His voice held the same booming sensuousness most barons at home would use when talking about mean tithes and heraldry and the idleness of the peasants. Like Matilda and Rudi, he'd been born in the first change year, but he looked older to her. Part of that was the fact that he also looked like the statue of an athlete that had been covered in an inch of soft tallow and left in the hot sun until it began to sag a little.
"Though I may be prejudiced," Matilda thought. "And he also looks like a man who trusts nobody, including the men who guard his sleep. They say Mom's that way, but she isn't. She always said paranoia was as stupid as gullibility, and just as likely to kill you."
Kate was tall and willowy. Her neck and fingers and piled dark hair sparkled with some truly impressive and not too gaudy jewelry, offset by the simply cut but obviously new blue silk of her knee-length dress. That had probably cost more. Jewelry could be salvaged, but silk had to be imported around the world over trade routes just beginning to function again.
"And unlike her demented spouse, she seems amiable enough. Not the brightest candle in the chandelier, but good-hearted."
"Oh, it's bad enough being married to the governor, much less being an, queen," Kate said. "I swear, I didn't expect everyone to be always asking for things before I married Tony. That was before his father died and he became boss man, of course."
"Ah, well, that is a drawback of being close to a sovereign," Matilda said.
She forced herself not to give an incredulous snort. What else would a ruler's consort or heir await? That was one reason she'd enjoyed her yearly stay with the Mackenzies so much after the Protector's War. There on the clan's land, she was just Rudy's friend Matilda.
"What did you expect when you married the ruler here, Kate?"
she thought, but did not say.
"Gossiping with the other good wives at the village bakery while your husband digs the garden or sits in the tavern with his cronies over a mug of beer?"
Instead, she turned to take a real drink off a tray. It was something sweet but potent in a glass like a cone on a stem, with a little cherry on top. For the first time in her life, she understood the temptation that made some people drink to excess. It wasn't so much a matter of drowning sorrows as of untangling the knot of fear that curdled under her breastbone, or at least putting a slight glassy layer between her and it. There wasn't anything she could do about the fear. She was here. The guards wouldn't let her leave. Rudi was in hideous danger across the river among the savages with only a Dane at his side. Poor Ingolf was in a dungeon, and most of the rest of her friends were hiding God knew where in this vast alien city. Even dear, kindly Father Ignatius was away, so that she couldn't confess or receive the sacraments.
But God does know where each is, as he sees every sparrow. Mary, pierced with sorrows, watch over the ones I love, and especially Rudi. Everything depends on him, and I miss him so much.
And sometimes I wish I was back on Father's farm, Kate went on. She probably felt freer to speak with a stranger than with most of her courtiers.
Farm. Ah, she means a barony, Matilda translated.
They'd kept the old words here, but a tract one family could work with machines before the change needed scores or hundreds now, with the landholder as lord.
A manor. A knight's fee, at least.
Instead of all this, I like a party, but they're all the same, and there are so many of them. And a lot of the people aren't really here for the fun.
I get the same feeling at balls and tournaments, Matilda said. Sometimes. As Mom says, they're our working time. If God calls you to a station, you have to do your best, whether it's peasant or princess. With princes and nobles, socializing is a big part of the business of ruling. Things that come up formally at councils really get settled first while you're feasting or hawking or hunting or dancing a pavane.
This is a fine country, Kate said softly after a moment. We Iowans have so much more than anyone else. Our parents were so lucky. Why do people have to quarrel and fight each other for more?
Matilda bowed her head slightly, honoring the sentiment, if not the thought.
Why indeed, she said. But that seems to be the way people are, a lot of them. It's a ruler's duty to keep their quarrels from spilling too much blood.
And to lead in war so that the realm's strength is a single blade of power in a skilled hand, she thought unhappily. But in the West, we have no single ruler to fight the prophet. The meeting is well enough, but it's a council and never gets anything done quickly. Most of the time, it's much better at stopping things than doing them.
The thought carked at her. Her own duty.
But the rest of the meeting realms will never accept an Arminger. The Protector's War showed that. They don't hate and fear me the way they did Father, but they would if they thought I wanted to be Overlord. And our nobles wouldn't accept anyone.
A thought made her eyes go wide.
But the Association would accept the man who brought back the Sword of the Lady and led them to victory. It could just as well be the Virgin who's the Lady as some pagan goddess, after all. Not accept him as Lord Protector in Portland, but as, what do the ancient Gael call it, an Ard Ri, a High King over all the realms. And they most certainly would accept it, if by my marrying that man they could have their own Lord Protector's blood on the throne in another generation.
The thought passed through her mind in an instant, but her blood leapt at an image of Rudi beside her and a cheering host of Associates and Mackenzies, Bear Killers and Corvallans, and many more below, crying him hail. Her heart beat even harder at the thought of him leading her to a bride's bower. How Rudi would love that, and hate the idea of a crown, and how well he'd do at both.
But right now he's over there in the wilderness, and I'm a prisoner in everything but name, and likely to lose my head if my attention strays. Concentrate, woman.
Kate had sighed and nodded, looking around.
There are always people who won't live peacefully, like the Hewissings. Why, when we have all this?
Candles burned on the tables, whose snowy linen held the buffet. The aide brought them a second set of hand-sized plates, this time with garlicky meatballs on toothpicks, and little skewers of hot, spicy grilled chicken, and tiny, tender vegetables. Some of the guests plowed stolidly through cold meats and breads and salads and dishes of spiced pickled fish, or nibbled on candied fruits, while others punished the wet bar and grew red-faced and expansive, or brooded in corners.
It scares me sometimes, the boss man's wife said softly.
Then, in an undertone, but fiercely,
"And people are always flattering Anthony, and telling him anything he wants to hear. It's like water dripping on iron."
Matilda turned away diplomatically, watching the crowd as Kate stammered and flushed, and then cast her a grateful look for letting the matter drop. Younger men and women flirted. Serious-looking ones in middle age stood in small circles, holding drinks and talking politics and business, or possibly just gossiping. A chamber group of musicians tootled away at something soothing in a corner, and the air smelled of fine food, wine, perfume, warm linen, and wool, a little of sweat and perfume, and strongly of expensive beeswax candles.
"Like the feast before the High Council meets," Matilda thought.
If you mentally substituted colorful modern tunic and hose and cotehardies for the drab antique Iowan costumes, and tabards for the servants' white coats and bow ties. The occasional lidded glances were easy enough to catch, and the way factions avoided each other accidentally on purpose. She'd grown up in a real court, after all, where her own frowns or smiles could set feuds going. Granted, it was the court run by her mother. Her father had been killed in the Protector's War when she was 10, but the Lady Regent had known how to do things. She'd been in the society before the change, where the knowledge of such things was kept alive. Iowa was large and rich, and far more populous than any of the realms around the Columbia and Willamette, or even all of them together.
"More than 2.5 million people. 120,000 just in this one city."
But in some ways it was a bit old-fashioned. A good many of the older men here were actually wearing suits with jacket and tie, for example, or military uniforms based on those of the old American Republic, though more favored the bib overalls and billed feed store cap that were a gentleman's garb in Iowa, the mark of a farmer or sheriff, which was what they called knights and barons.
"And they're running a court, but doing it badly, as if they were stumbling through an unfamiliar dance, or like children in a catechism class with a half-literate teacher. What they really need is someone to tell them how to do it properly." "Their dress looks absolutely gorgeous," Kate went on, brightening once more. "What's it called again?" "A cotehardie. There's an arcane terminology for every bit of it. This headdress is a wrapped wimple, for instance." "Beautiful," she said. "Those carved rose crystal buttons down the front and sleeves, and the lace. I've never seen such fine needlework either." "Well, Mother does have the best. But right from the beginning, my parents went looking for craftspeople. They were thinking ahead."
She flicked her wrist, and the ivory leaves of her long-handled fan opened out to make a tracery of tiny figures that showed children dancing around a maypole.
"By now we have a lot of fine makers, for practical things, and for beautiful ones as well. And not just in my mother's household. This was a present from a friend, Lady Delia de Stafford."
"Lovely,"
Kate said, taking it for a moment and holding it up against a light. She hesitated and then went on.
"But isn't that dress, well, isn't it all a bit cumbersome?"
Matilda laughed.
"It certainly is if you don't have a lady-in-waiting and a couple of maidservants to help you on and off with it," she said, "which I suspect was part of the point. That's why it's a noblewoman style."
At home she wore male dress as often as her special status let her get away with it, and hated the constriction of the court fashion's button sleeves and bodice, and the way you couldn't lift your arms above your shoulders, and the long full skirts and the wrapped headdress, though even that was better than the tall cone-shaped ones. The two tunics and shift of commoner female costume were much more comfortable and less confining. But noble women could get away with that only in the most casual settings. She'd have just chucked the clothes chest herself. God and his mother knew that they'd lost most of the gear they'd started out with in Bend at one emergency or another, which had included everything from battle and headlong flight to million-strong stampedes of mad buffalo. Now she was glad she hadn't insisted. It made her feel a little less frightened and homesick, and it emphasized that she wasn't officially just a prisoner here. and the warm browns and golds of the silk and embroidery did complement her seal-brown hair and hazel eyes and warm, light olive complexion. She wasn't beautiful. Her features took after her father's, too bold and a little irregular. But she knew she could be striking.
"And I have to uphold the Portland Protective Association's honor here. These Iowans think everyone else is a monkey from the wilds, or at best a hick."
"You look enchanting, Your Highness," Odard Lu said.
He came up to them, a middle-sized young man, black-haired and olive umber of skin, slim and elegant in party-colored hose and curl-toed shoes with little silver bells, trailing dagged sleeves and hood with tippets and gold-link belt. His slanted blue eyes amused, and his lute over his back, troubadour fashion.
Some of the younger local gentry as well trailed, who looked fascinated, the more so when he made an elaborate leg bow and hand flourish to both women, the long tail of his round, flat nobleman's hat fluttering and sweeping the floor as he drew it through the complex measure. "And Your Majesty is also enchanting in her own person, if I may be so bold," he went on to Kate Heselrode. "Your lord is to be envied for his wealth and power, but not least for the jeweled beauty of his consort." Everyone loves flattery, but keep in mind that when people deal with royalty, they lay it on with a trowel, Matilda's mother had told her once. Your friend Odard at least does it with some style. He'd also clung to the box with their last court outfits inside, like grim death, even when they were starving in that cave in the Rockies, wondering if they'd have to eat the horses while the blizzards howled outside. He'd laid out gold here to have his gear repaired, too. And hers, to be sure. "But though Iowa is rich and mighty, I say that only in Portland do we know how to praise fair ladies." Odard brought his lute around and strummed. His fingers teased out a stately tune, one of his own.
"Oh, no," Matilda thought. "Not that one."
The chamber group had fallen silent. His smile was half warm and half a teasing pleasure in her embarrassment as he sang a chorus in a pleasant tenor. "So let the hall ring for the light of the north, for the Princess Matilda, the light of the north."
"Odard, I still haven't forgiven you for composing that," she said, and
rapped his knuckles with her fan. He grinned unrepentantly as he shook the hand and then went on. "I was just telling these good fellows about the high tournament of the association."
"Great stuff," one of them said enthusiastically. "We have reserve drills and National Guard muster days at the county fairs, but nothing that fancy. It sounds like a hell of a lot of fun."
"Not when you're smacked right off your horse and knocked silly, and you throw up inside a close helm and they have to unharness you with bolt cutters," Matilda said with feeling. "Or when a horse breaks something and screams until they put it down. I always hate that part."
"Girls compete?" Kate said, interested.
"The princess is a special case, to be sure," Odard said smoothly. "And of course the current Grand Constable of the Association, Lady Tefane, Baroness Dath. Apart from them, no, not very often. Though one young lady is always crowned Queen of Love and Beauty by the winner." Matilda choked back a gurgling laugh. 2 years ago, Tefane Dath had won, and the Grand Constable had ridden up to the stands and dropped the crown from the point of her lance into the lap of her lady-in-waiting, Delia de Stafford, at which the local bishop had nearly choked on the blessing, since everyone knew about Tefane and Delia.
"That was wicked of her. Funny, yes, but wicked."
Though nobody spoke about it, unless they wanted to face Baroness Dath in a duel, which wasn't anything a sane human being would do unless they were tired of life. Matilda sighed a little, struck by sudden homesickness.
"In the unlikely event that I ever win a tournament."
She knew herself to be fair to middling at best, despite a lifetime's coaching by experts, without the supernatural speed and skill that Dath used to compensate for men's greater raw strength.
"I'm going to crown myself Queen of Love and Beauty, and nobody else. Or maybe I could crown Rudi King of Love and Beauty. All the warrior saints witness he's beautiful."
Odard went on, diplomatically ignoring her sudden flush. I'm surprised you don't have tournaments here. Weren't there any society people in Iowa? In most places which survived at all, they did very well. A new voice broke in.
Oh, there were some here in Des Moines. Dad said he found them very useful as instructors, the craftsmen and the fighters at least. The rest were sort of flaky. He didn't want anything to do with all that ceremonial they liked so much.
Matilda concealed a start. That was the boss man, just breaking away from the people she didn't want him talking to. The emissaries from Corwin in Montana. The red-robed and shaven-skulled priest of the Church Universal and Triumphant. And the hard-eyed officer of the Sword of the Prophet who'd been pursuing them ever since they left Oregon. Anthony Heaselrode saw her glare at them and waved them away. Being here on sufferance themselves, they went, not without glares of their own.
Dad always said you could afford to have people curse you in private, but not laugh.
Pride stiffened Matilda's spine, and she sank in the formal curtsy her tutors had drilled into her in girlhood. When she spoke, her voice was cool courtesy.
I'm sure your father was a very able man, my lord bossman, she said, but so was mine. Portland lives, when all the other great cities on the West Coast died, and I assure you, nobody laughed when he was styled Majesty or my lord, not more than once at least, your Majesty.
Then Matilda saw the glitter in his pale eyes. There was something not quite right there.
You say that word, Majesty, with such conviction, Heaselrode said. I could get used to it, if people said it the way you do, and if I was sure you're not trying to disrespect me.
Matilda met his eyes.
If he says kill her, the guardsmen will cut me down, she thought. You can see it in their eyes. Most of them would do anything he said.
There was a slight hush around them. Even Kate stiffened, until the boss man chuckled and nodded. People relaxed, and the bubble of silence collapsed inward again. She felt a slight trickle of sweat down her spine, more than the heavy clothing and sticky warm night warranted, and she sipped at the sweet, strong liquor again. That wouldn't have happened at the palace at home, or Castle Todenokst. Sandra
Arminger. We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.